Good morning, students. Chapter 2, Human Reproduction. In the last class, we have discussed about the maintenance of pregnancy and embryonic development. And we are continuing the topic. So we have seen about the extra embryonic membranes. The extra embryonic membranes, namely yolk sac, allantois, amnion and chorion. So their main function is to protect the embryo from desiccation, mechanical shock, and helps in the absorption of nutrients and exchange of gases. And also we have seen about the placenta and its function. So the placenta does the nutritive, respiratory and excretory functions. Next, the human pregnancy lasts for about 280 days. So the human pregnancy lasts for about 280 days or 40 weeks, and they are called as gestation period. So gestation period means it is the pregnancy. So the gestation period or the human pregnancy is divided for convenience into three trimesters for 3 months each. So totally there are 9 months, and they are dividing each 3 months. So the first 3 months is called as the first trimester. The second 3 months is called as the second trimester, and the last 3 months is called as the third trimester. So the gestation period is divided into three trimesters of 3 months each. So the first trimester is the main period of organogenesis. So that is in the first 3 months. So the first 3 months is called as the first trimester, and it is the period of organogenesis. What do you mean by organogenesis? That is formation of organs. The body organs, namely the heart, limbs, lungs, liver and external genital organs, are all well developed. So in the first 3 months, organ formation takes place. That is called as organogenesis. By the end of the second trimester, the phase is well formed with futures. So in the next 3 months, that is 4, 5 and 6th month, the face is well formed with futures, eyelids and eyelashes, eye blink, body is covered with fine hair, muscle tissue develops and bones become harder. So by the end of the second trimester, the face is well formed with futures. So all the features in the face develops, eyelids and eyelashes, eye blink, body is covered with fine hair, muscle tissue develops and bone becomes harder. So these are the development which takes place in the second trimester. In the third trimester, that is at the last 3 months, the height and weight of the baby increases. That is, the height and weight of the fetus increases, because all the features or all the body organs have been formed at the end of the second trimester. At the third trimester, that is at the last 3 months, 7, 8, 9, the height and weight of the fetus increases. So the fetus is fully developed and it is ready for delivery by the end of the 9th month. So by the end of the 9th month, the fetus is fully developed and it is ready for the delivery. So these are the development which takes place in the three trimester. So this we call it as the, that is gestation period or the human pregnancy. Next we'll see about the, that is during pregnancy, the placenta acts as a temporary endocrine gland. So placenta, we have seen what is placenta. Placenta is a temporary endocrine gland formed during pregnancy, and it connects the fetus to the uterine wall through the umbilical cord. It is the organ by which the nutritive, respiratory and excretory functions are fulfilled. So the placenta is the organ which is formed only during the pregnancy, and the main function of the placenta is to fulfill the nutritive, respiratory and excretory functions of the fetus. So during pregnancy, the placenta acts as a temporary endocrine gland. So it is called as a temporary endocrine gland because it acts as an endocrine gland only at the time of pregnancy. So it is called as the temporary endocrine gland. Why it is called as endocrine gland means it secretes or produces some hormones. So we'll see what are the hormones which are secreted by the placenta. So the placenta produces large quantities of human chorionic gonadotrophin, that is HCG. Human chorionic somatomammotrophin, that is HCS, or human placental lactogen, that is HPL, estrogens and progesterone. So these are the hormones which are secreted by the placenta. So what are the name of the hormones? Human chorionic gonadotrophin, HCG, human chorionic somatomammotrophin, that is HCS, or human placental lactogen, that is HPL, estrogen and progesterone, which are essential for the normal maintenance of pregnancy. So at the later phase, that is at the end of pregnancy, a hormone called as relaxin is also secreted during the, that is later phase of pregnancy. So the end of pregnancy, a hormone called relaxin is also secreted. And what is the main function of relaxin? Is to help in the relaxation of the pelvic ligaments at the time of parturition. So what is the main function of relaxin? Is to relax the pelvic ligaments. So the pelvic ligaments are relaxed at the time of parturition. Parturition means delivery. And it should be noted that HGC, HPL and relaxins are produced only during the pregnancy. So certain hormones are produced only at the time of pregnancy. And what are the hormones means? That is HCG. What do you mean by HCG? That is human chorionic gonadotrophin. HPL, that is human placental lactogen, and relaxin. So these hormones are produced only at the time of pregnancy. So in addition, during pregnancy, the level of other hormones. So what are the additional hormones secreted during pregnancy means? That is estrogen and progesterone, cortisol, prolactin, thyroxine, etc. So in addition, during pregnancy, the level of other hormones like estrogen and progesterone, cortisol, prolactin, thyroxine is increased several folds. That is, it is increased many times in the maternal blood. These hormones are essential for supporting the fetal growth. So apart from the other hormones, in addition, during pregnancy, the level of other hormones like estrogen, progesterone, cortisol, prolactin, thyroxine is increased several times in the maternal blood. Maternal means mother. So these hormones are essential for supporting the fetal growth. Next, we are going to see the topic parturition and lactation. First, we'll see parturition. So parturition, that is the action of giving birth, or we can say childbirth or delivery. So the parturition is commonly called as childbirth or delivery. So what is parturition? Parturition is the completion of pregnancy and giving birth to the baby. So parturition means it is the completion of pregnancy. That is, the pregnancy is going to complete and the baby is going to expel out from the mother's womb. The series of events that expels the infant from the uterus is collectively called as labor. So what do you mean by labor means? It is a series of events that expels the infant from the uterus is collectively called as labor. So only we are calling it as labor pain. So throughout pregnancy, the uterus undergoes periodic episodes of weak and strong contractions. So throughout the period of pregnancy, the uterus undergoes periodic episodes of weak and strong contractions. These contractions are called as Braxcher-Hicks contractions. So what do you mean by Braxcher-Hicks contraction means? During the or throughout the period of pregnancy, the uterus undergoes periodic episodes of weak and strong contractions, and these contractions are called as Braxcher-Hicks contraction. And this contraction does not lead to labor. That means it does not result in labor. It leads to false labor. That is, it is otherwise called as false pain also, because this Braxcher-Hicks contraction will not result in labor. It leads to false labor. As the pregnancy progresses, increase in estrogen concentration promotes the uterine contractions. Why this uterine contraction takes place means? Because as the pregnancy progresses, that is, as the pregnancy is day by day increasing, increase in the estrogen concentration. So the estrogen concentration is increased, and due to this estrogen concentration only, the uterine contraction takes place. The uterine contractions facilitate molting of the fetus and downward movement of the fetus. So due to this uterine contraction, what will happen means the fetus position will comes to, that is, downward movement. So the fetus rotates and it comes downwards. The descent of the fetus causes dilation of the cervix. So the descent of the fetus means the fetus position comes downwards, and due to this dilation of the cervix of the uterus. Dilation means expansion of the cervix and the vaginal canal results in the neurohumoral reflex called as fetal ejection reflex or the Ferguson reflex. So what do you mean by fetal ejection reflex or Ferguson reflex means, so when the due to the descent of the fetus causes dilation of the cervix of the uterus and vaginal canal, resulting in the neurohumoral reflex, or otherwise called as fetal ejection reflex or the Ferguson reflex. This initiates the secretion of the oxytocin. So due to this Ferguson reflex, that is due to the descent of the fetus, it initiates the secretion of oxytocin from the neurohypophysis, which in turn brings about the powerful contractions of the uterine muscles and leads to the expulsion of the baby through the birth canal. And this sequence of events is called as the parturition or the childbirth. So due to the Ferguson reflex, what will happen means it initiates the secretion of the oxytocin hormone from the neurohypophysis, which in turn it brings about the powerful contractions. So the oxytocin brings about powerful contractions of the uterine muscles, and due to this powerful contraction, it results in the expulsion of the baby, that is, the baby is going to come outside from the mother's womb, so through the birth canal. So this sequence of events is called as the parturition or the childbirth. So this is about the parturition, or otherwise called as the childbirth. Relaxin is a hormone secreted by the placenta. We have seen that at the end of pregnancy, the relaxin hormone is secreted. And what is the main function of relaxin is to relax the pelvic ligaments at the time of parturition. So relaxin is a hormone secreted by the placenta and also found in the corpus luteum. It promotes parturition by relaxing the pelvic ligaments and by dilation of the cervix with continued powerful contractions. The amnion ruptures. We have seen one extra embryonic membrane, isn't it? Amnion. And the amnion also contains amniotic fluid, which protects the baby from shocks and jerks. So this amnion ruptures and the amniotic fluid flows down through the vagina. So before that is parturition, the amnion ruptures and the amniotic fluid flows out through the vagina, followed by the uterus. First, the amniotic fluid flows through the vagina, and after that, it is followed by the fetus. The placenta, along with the remains of the umbilical cord, called as afterbirth, is expelled out after delivery. So, after, that is after delivery or after parturition, what will happen means the placenta and also the remains of the umbilical cord, so they are called as afterbirth. They also will get expelled. They also comes out through the, that is, birth canal, expelled out after delivery. So these are the organs which are formed only during the time of pregnancy, that is placenta, umbilical, all this. So after delivery, this remains also will come outside of the body. So this is called as after birth. Next, we are going to see about the topic lactation. So what is lactation means? Lactation is the production of milk by the mammary gland. So we have already seen the structure of the mammary gland. So what is the main function of mammary gland means? To secrete the milk. So lactation means it is the production of milk by the mammary glands. The mammary glands show changes during every menstrual cycle during pregnancy and lactation. So the mammary glands show changes during every menstrual cycle and also during pregnancy and lactation. Increased level of estrogen, progesterone and human placental lactogen, that is HPL, towards the end of pregnancy stimulate the hypothalamus towards prolactin releasing factors. So at the end of pregnancy, what will happen means the level of, that is estrogen, progesterone and human placental lactogen. So all these hormones are increased at the end of pregnancy. So due to this increase of these hormones, it stimulate the hypothalamus to secrete the prolactin releasing factor. So these hormones, it will stimulate the hypothalamus to secrete the prolactin releasing factors. The anterior pituitary responds by secreting prolactin, which plays a major role in lactogenesis. So due to this, that is stimulate the hypothalamus, the anterior pituitary, it secretes the prolactin hormone. So the anterior pituitary secretes the prolactin hormone. And what is the role of prolactin hormone means? It plays a major role in lactogenesis. What do you mean by lactogenesis? Genesis means synthesis. Synthesis of milk. That is, synthesis or production of milk is called as lactogenesis. So prolactin is responsible for the synthesis of milk in the mammary gland. Next, oxytocin causes another one hormone called as oxytocin. It causes the let down reflex, the actual ejection of milk from the alveoli of the mammary gland. So we have already seen that is prolactin is responsible for the synthesis of milk, and another hormone called as oxytocin is responsible for the ejection of milk from the alveoli of the mammary gland. So it causes the let down reflex. So what do you mean by let down reflex? Means the hormone oxytocin is responsible for the ejection of the milk from the alveoli of the mammary glands. So during lactation, oxytocin also stimulates the recently emptied uterus to contract, helping it to return to the pre-pregnancy size. So what is the another role of oxytocin? Means it stimulates the recently emptied, that is after delivery, the empty uterus is there, no? The empty uterus will contract and it will return to its pre-pregnancy size. So this is due to the secretion of the hormone oxytocin. So after delivery, the mammary gland secretes a yellowish fluid called as colostrum during the initial few days after parturition. That is after delivery, the mammary gland secretes a yellowish fluid called as colostrum. It has less lactose than milk. So when compared to milk, the lactose content is very less in the colostrum. And the colostrum has no fat, but it contains more proteins, vitamin A and minerals. So the colostrum, it has no fat and less lactose, and also it contains more proteins, vitamin A and minerals. So the colostrum is also rich in the IgA antibodies. So IgA antibodies is rich in colostrum. It helps to protect the infant digestive tract against the bacterial infection. So this IgA antibodies protects the infant's digestive tract against the bacterial infection. So the breast milk is the ideal food for infants, as it contains all the constituents in suitable concentration and it is easily digestible. So the breast milk, that is the mother's milk, is the best food for the infants because it contains all the constituents in suitable concentration and also it is easily digestible. So that is milk powder or cow's milk is not suitable for the baby. Only mother's milk is suitable for the baby. It is fully sufficient till about 6 months of age. So the mother's milk is sufficient for the baby till the 6th month of age, and all infants must be breastfed by the mother to ensure the growth of a healthy baby. So this is about the topic lactation. So almost we have covered this topic and we have come to the end. So till this we are concluding the topic. So go through this topic. In the next class we'll be starting with the new chapter. Thank you.